Good afternoon, or maybe I should say good morning. I'm not sure what time it is right now, but you're watching DTC, and they are producing the Cannon County Chamber Connection Show, and we're glad to have you with us here today. We do have some guests, surprisingly, because this is the 1st of March, and it has come in like a lion. Hopefully it will go out like a lamb, but the weather is really bad. So we're proud to have all these people here. And I have my co-host with me today, Sue Connolly, and of course she's the Vice President of the Chamber of Commerce. My name is Carolyn Motley, and I'm the coordinator. And we welcome you here, and like I say, we thank DTC for promoting us and several other chambers, because they do that out of the goodness of their heart, and we do appreciate it.
Yes, we do.
Sue, you've been to London?
I've been to London to visit the Queen.
And how did that work?
Oh, it was great. It was great. Yeah, I spent a month in London. My son had his musical produced, and
he got
rave reviews. I was telling Josh that it got 5-star review in the Vanity Fair of Europe, and it's gotten just great reviews. It's called The Sorrows of Satan by Michael Conley, written by Michael Conley and Luke Bateman. It was just awesome.
Good.
Yeah,
I'm
we
so
had a great
proud.
Time. I was very proud of him.
Okay, and you walked a long way.
I did. Well, I babysat. So while he was working on his play, I took care of my grandson.
Sue is like a technical walking robot. Everything on her either answers something or rings or does. She has a watch that she talks into, which just blows my mind. And I'm sure you have all that thing and throughout your house that
I do.
You can ask
I do.
Questions.
I do. I have it all through my house.
How many times has it ordered things from Amazon that you have talked about?
Only that I've wanted. It's not ordered things that I have not wanted. But it's great. I have it. Alexa talks to me all the time.
This is scary, Sue.
I know.
She's listening to everything you say. You better watch out, girl.
I don't say much.
Oh, shoot. I know better than that. Anyway, we do have some guests here with us today, even on this stormy day. To my right, we have Kaylin Holloway. And Kaylin is here with us today for an organization that is, I want to say, I'm sorry that we need it, but we do so need it. And it's the Child Advocacy Center. How are you today, Keith?
Oh, I'm doing good. I appreciate you having me, Carolyn and Sue. I really do. I made it through the drive in the rain, so I'm just happy to be here.
It's really been bad
today.
I'm
just happy to be here.
I bet you are. You know, you have an office here in Woodbury, mm-hmm. and it's the Child Advocacy Center. Why don't you tell us a little bit about exactly what the Child Advocacy Center is all about?
Gladly. Office here, we're in the old jail, just right behind the courthouse. So what we do is we provide services to child sexual abuse victims and their non-offending family members. So we do that through forensic interviewing, and that's working as a multidisciplinary team with the district attorney, law enforcement, Department of Children's Services, and mental health counselors, because it's all about helping these children get out of their situations if they're being sexually abused, and then also providing them services to overcome.
So, and the family, right?
Yes, and the family to overcome. So we have a drug endangered children's coordinator that goes and works with the families in the home. We have the forensic interviewer that works with law enforcement to prosecute offenders. And then we also have a prevention that's basically what I do. I'm the community education coordinator person. And I go around and I teach prevention tips to churches, to schools, to anybody that works with children. So,
and really identification marks to my, how you would identify if this was happening, right?
Yeah. It's all about just preventing and how to recognize the signs, mm-hmm. and how to really react and report. So, and it's all about doing that, as well as being able to talk to your kids about anatomically correct body parts and just everything like that, trying to get this out in the open so that we're raising the level of consciousness and then people make reports, and hopefully we have the number of victims go down. Mm-hmm. That's our ultimate goal with this. So we want to essentially put ourselves out of business. So we, that's our main goal, is we don't want to see any child sexual abuse victims, but we have this in place to help those that have been abused, and we help them overcome.
Okay. So do you find that the families, you know, once there has been an accusation of sexual abuse to a child, and that's, they can't say, well, I'm not going to press charges. That's just too bad, so sad. The charges are pressed regardless of the other parent or the grandparents or whatever. I mean, there's no way you can say, I'm not going to press charges or things like that.
So what happens if there's the allegation, It goes to Department of Children's Services, and they have caseworkers and people that professionally will go out and investigate this stuff. And then if it's severe or like even mild abuse, they then work with law enforcement and present their case of their findings. And then they figure out what they can do to prosecute. And so severe child sexual abuse cases will be prosecuted by the district attorney, and they have been aggressively. I know the district attorney, Jennings Jones, now has two special prosecutors that focus solely on child sexual abuse. And so we have people that are in place and helping us really deal with this issue. And just in Cannon County, we've dealt with 121 individuals just last year alone. And then in our mid-year report to United Way, we have served just now a little over 100. So we've
and that's just
in the mid-year, and that's just in Cannon County. So we are serving a higher number of people in Cannon County, whether that's because of drug endangerment or that's because of sexual abuse. But we're seeing that we're serving more clients in Cannon County too, and we're trying to provide them with services that help them either kick their addiction or help the child sexual abuse victims really just find them some hope and healing.
Yeah. Like, I know in the hospital, anytime a child comes in or elder abuse or whatever, we are required by law to report that. So I'm assuming teachers are required by law to report
teachers
that.
Teachers are mandated reporters.
Who
pretty
else?
Much anybody that serves youth.
Okay.
I know I've gone to a lot of nonprofits. I've gone to, like, some youth-serving organizations, and I've worked to create a reporting policy and have talked about it with them during these trainings about who do you report to. And it's really great, because I think what now we've done, we've started holding more schools accountable. And so more teachers know who to report to, they know where to report to, and they know that they're mandated reporters. So a lot of people that are working with kids now are being held more accountable than go back two decades ago. And so they're required by law to have child sexual abuse training now, most of these schools and youth serving organizations.
Good.
So we're just working to provide a free training to people, because some people do charge for child sexual abuse training. And so ours is completely free, and we just go in and we just talk to them. And we just give them the facts about their local community, and we try to just give them something that they can take and use professionally, or they can use it personally in their own lives. So,
and this would also could be done with, you have a lot of volunteer coaches, people that deal with children. I'm not saying, oh heavens, I'm not saying that these are all have problems. I'm just saying that if you're dealing with children in any capacity, as a coach, as a little league, as everybody in the block, that you really should have some of this type of training that you do realize.
I agree with that wholeheartedly, honestly.
If you
serve with children in any facet, then you should just have this training, because it's a real issue. And it just lets you kind of, it just allows you to read children a lot better, and lets you kind of, it shapes your perspective, basically. So I think that it really helps in just dealing with kids and professionally being around kids, but also personally, it helps people know that everybody has different experiences. So
you would give this training to, if some organization got all of these people that are dealing with children as a coach or a volunteer or anything, you would come up and give this training, and what's called Darkness to Light.
Yes, ma'am. It is Darkness to Light, Stewards of Children training. It's a two-hour training that we promote. And so I give it to anybody in the community that wants to be trained on this and really wants to gain more knowledge. And
realize what it is.
Yeah, and we are a United Way funded program.
So I was going to ask about that. United Way funds you. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we're United Way funded and we're held accountable by them. And then I also provide resources to mental health counselors whenever I'm there.
But you also, because I know that the chamber has done toy cruise-ins for the Child Advocacy Center in the past, and because these families are, a lot of them are in need, and so you do fundraisers to help with this.
Yeah.
But it's all accounted for, and the money that's raised here goes to Cannon County families, right?
Yeah, and I think that's the biggest point that I want to make is that all the money that's raised in Cannon County stays in Cannon County because we have the Child Advocacy Center of Rutherford County and we have the Child Advocacy Center of Cannon County. And so those two separate entities, except we have part-time staff members that come down and work in Cannon County, the Drug Endangered Children's Coordinator and our forensic interviewer. So basically, we do fundraising events. We did Andrea Walks in the past with Andrea Conte, Governor Phil Bredesen's wife.
Right.
And that was a big fundraiser. But now we're trying to get more community support like that. And so that's why we're doing a 5K here in Cannon County on Saturday, April 1st. We want to have a steady fundraising source, and we want to gain more income here in Cannon County to get somebody from the community to work in here as a full-time staff person. And really, I think if we have a full-time staff person out here, that would really help with how the operations go in Cannon County.
Because right now the office is only open on a part-time basis, right?
Whenever we have people down here on Tuesdays and Thursdays, we have part-time people, so it's only open sometimes. Or if it's severe, then we come down. Obviously, we'll come down anytime. But
I know Sue and I have taken families from the Child Advocacy Center before.
Yeah, probably through our Secret Santa program. So that's a really great program, and that helps some kids here in Cannon County that otherwise wouldn't have had a Christmas.
Yeah, but it's not only people who are needy that have their children are sexually abused.
Yeah.
I mean, it's every level of income. Things that happen, and sometimes if someone is educated and everything, you think that they would not do something like that. But do you find on most of these cases, were these people abused as children as well? Do you find that, or do you not go that far?
So I always say that sexual abuse does not discriminate.
Yeah,
the
I
color,
agree.
Socioeconomic status, whatever. I always say that it just doesn't discriminate. There is a known cycle of abuse that professionals do talk about where the person that has been abused then turns around whenever they grow up and they act on these things and then become an abuser. So that's very normal. But that's not always the case.
Yeah.
It's very individualistic.
Yeah.
So it's very much a case by case basis. So
do you also talk to children as well? Because I know a lot of abusers will tell the kids, don't, if you tell anybody, I'll kill your family or something. They do. They say horrible things like that.
Right.
So how do you, lots of times the kids won't report because they're scared or they think they've done something wrong. You know, kids always think everything's their fault.
Right. That's always a tough issue to tackle.
Yeah.
There's always many things, and that's what really hurts is that sometimes whenever the child is abused, it's by somebody that's gained trust with the child and then makes it seem like it's okay to not report. So there's a lot of fears of reporting child sexual abuse. And so that's what I go around and I basically try to dispel that and just try to teach that it's all about that you open a line of communication with a child that you might believe is being sexually abused and not confront them specifically and say, are you being sexually abused? But just saying what happened and asking open-ended questions and just saying, hey, I noticed that you're kind of acting out. Do you want to talk about it? Or something like that along those lines of just being an open line of communication. So that's basically what I try to talk about in our Darkness to Light training sessions.
Well, thanks for doing such
that
a great
is.
Job, because that's an important part.
It is.
It's an awesome thing that you're doing.
Yeah, it is.
Again,
we want to mention about this 5K run walk. Mm-hmm. It's going to be April 1st at Dillon Park.
Yep, and it's not an April Fool's joke. It's actually happening. It is not an April Fool's
joke.
Well,
if I came over there and ran 5K, it would be a few.
You can walk, though, too.
Yes, you can walk. And we're just going to be in Dillon Park, and we have the route set up. And so we have that online at runsignup.com. All you got to do is just go search Canyon Runs for Children, and it'll pop up instantly. And we're just hoping to have a great event in Woodbury and have some people from Canyon County come represent and have a little bit of competition for those that want to run, but then also just kind of enjoy the day. Hopefully we have a nice, beautiful day, unlike today, and have a nice, sunny Saturday afternoon, Saturday morning, so that way we can just have a good event.
So. We had a 5K in the rain one time.
Oh, wow. Well,
it wasn't like this, but it was raining. But, you know, the ones that are serious about running, they don't care.
They don't.
They'll run in the rain.
Yeah, and so we've had some people in the Canyon County community help us. They're helping support this race. And so we've been really thankful for the people that we've been working with. And we just look forward to create a solid base for this event and then just keep it going annually and just try and keep growing and growing. So.
But people don't pre-register, though. They can register that morning,
yeah,
right?
You can register day of, or you can go online and pre-register, whichever one. We'll have some volunteers and some staff members out there to help people register for the event.
Okay. Starts at 7 a.m.
Yep, 7 a.m. I know.
It's good.
I'm not much of a morning person, but I'll be out there, and I'll be bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and so I'll be ready.
Well, I have to see that, right? I'd bushy tail. I have to come out there just see that. Thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
For coming on and explaining that to us.
Yeah.
And that's a good event. It serves a good purpose.
Mm-hmm. Well, so. We just want to help the children of Canyon County and keep the money that's raised here in Canyon County and provide resources to people that need it.
That's good.
That's our ultimate goal.
That's good.
I'm all for that.
Me too.
Yeah.
Me too.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Caitlin. Yeah. And I'm sorry that I thought you were a woman when I read that name, because he walks in and I said, "And can I help you?" And he goes, "I'm here for the DTC taping." And I thought, okay, somebody I forgot. And I thought, "And who are you with?" And he said, "The child advocate." And I says, "Oh, I thought a lady was showing up."
Well, I've never had that happen. I've had my name pronounced three ways to Sunday, but I've never been perceived
goodness.
As a woman.
Well, so I hadn't first. Seen
that's
you.
Good.
I yeah. just had a name on a piece
right.
of paper.
Right, of course.
And Josh, I thought you were a woman as well.
Well, I can tell. It goes with the name. Yeah.
Well, thank you for being a part of it. And now I know that I've seen you. I know now.
Goodness sakes.
And good luck on this run.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate that.
Okay, Josh, you've been patiently sitting over here. And we're going to talk to you because you're a new member of the chamber.
Yes, ma'am.
And you are with the Experience Community. And I always think, okay, I got to finish this. Experience Community.
Yeah, and well, we're not a cult. I think I just put that out of here. Some people call us the Experiment Community. It's not that. It's the Experience Community.
I wasn't going to say cult. So, it is a church, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
That's the word I want to finish
with. Yes, ma'am. That'd be appropriate, yeah.
And right now you are located in Murfreesboro.
Yes.
But you're looking to head this way, aren't
you? Yes, ma'am, we are. We are about 10 years old. So we started about 10 years ago. It was our senior pastor, Corey Trimble, was his wife, and it was one other person. And they just had a vision for what God wanted to do in Murfreesboro. And so 10 years later, and about 2,500 people later, that's kind of where we are now.
You do have a big congregation.
We do, and sometimes I have no idea why, because we're all a bunch of idiots. So somehow God chose the weak things of this world to confound the wise.
I can hardly wait to tell my grandson since he goes to that church.
Yeah, well, yeah, he probably already knows if he knows me. But so we're...
We all fake it through life.
Absolutely.
Let me explain that to you. We all fake it till we make it. We just pretend we know what we're doing.
That's kind of why I'm here. I'm
That's
just pretending
right.
like I know what I'm doing.
Exactly.
We kind of started leaning into the Canyon County area, and we just had a lot of people kind of approach us and kind of ask about, you know, are you guys thinking of expanding and kind of bringing this community to other places? And so, honestly, for about 4 or 5 years, we've been praying about this and thinking about this and talking it over with our pastoral teams, our elders teams, and just really seeing, you know, is there an opportunity for us to engage the community in Cannon County with something a little bit different? We are a non-denominational, non-traditional, Bible-based church, and so that means we are a little bit different. We are a little bit more casual.
Your music is more contemporary because
yes,
I have been there and I know,
yes.
And it's great. I mean,
well,
it is.
And Josh was telling me that he actually got a scholarship playing the cello through college. And
but so most of my church doesn't know that, so don't let that out of the bag.
Okay.
You know,
we won't tell us.
I think I have to play the cello for all their weddings and all that stuff.
So we won't tell us.
On the DL. Yeah. So, yeah, you know, and so being in that area, you know, there's a lot of artists and musicians that tend to be the kind of community that we attract because, again, we're a little bit different, and the arts and the music kind of play a big piece into what we do. And so, you know, if you visit our worship center in Murfreesboro, you'll see original artwork all along the walls, mm-hmm. and we have different musicians that will, you know, tour with artists in the Nashville area that, you know, when they're in town, that's where they choose to worship. And so that's kind of the culture that we've created because we believe God is the creator. That's how he revealed himself in the pages of scripture. And so we want to be, as people made in his image, creators as well. We want to be creative and kind of cultivate that culture. And so, yeah, that's a little bit about who we are.
Hmm. Well, that sounds pretty exciting, I'll tell you.
I've been there.
Yeah.
It's good.
It's
yeah.
different. Did you think we were cult when you first came in? It's okay. You can say
I
yes.
questioned my grandson about it. I got to say I did. And I said, and you're going to what?
Well, it's funny is, you know, a lot of people with a name like the Experience Community, you know, people kind of, you know, put
well,
back
I want to end it. I want to put something else
oh,
on
yeah,
the
go
end
ahead.
There.
Yeah.
No, I mean, when you say
oh, sure,
the
yeah.
Experience Community, I want another word there.
Yeah. You want to say church. Yeah. You want to say church on the end of it.
Well, and it's funny is, you know, with as artistic and kind of unorthodox as our methods are, our message really doesn't change. And so something somebody will notice if they choose to worship with us is the way that we do teaching, it might be a little different from way somebody might have grown up in it. And that is we go chapter by chapter, verse by verse through the Bible. And so it's really not based on my opinion or based on another pastor's opinion. It is opening what we believe to be the Word of God, inspired by God, infallible, inerrant Word of God, and we read it chapter by chapter, verse by verse, and really our aim is not to try to add to it or take away from it, but rather to see what does it say and how should I change my life to follow that. So it's
because everybody gets a different opinion.
Sure. And so we want to, as followers of Jesus, make this about following him, not just following what I want to do or what you want to do.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, as weird as we might seem, as, you know.
No, I didn't think you were weird.
Oh, that's okay.
I thought
you did.
I didn't. I'm telling you, I didn't.
Okay.
No, I didn't think you were weird. You were different. The music was different. It wasn't. You just sit down and sing out of a book, you know. I mean, it was inspiring, I guess. That's what the word I'm looking for. It really was. And I was surprised to see so many people from Cannon County attending.
Yeah, and that's something that we started noticing, and we kind of started asking ourselves, you know, is this something that we could bring to this area? Because, you know, when we started looking and praying and doing the research, what we found out is there's, according to U.S. Census data, there's about 7,700, so almost 8,000 people in Cannon County that don't regularly attend a house of worship.
Yeah.
And that's close to 56% of the population here in this community that either wouldn't feel comfortable going to a church, or maybe they grew up in a church and they just thought, you know, this really isn't for me, or you know, they might be a little bit different just like us. And so they're looking for a place to ask those questions of what is this whole Jesus thing about? And so we really felt like God was leading us to come to this community and serve and kind of provide that place. And, you know, I'll just go on the record and say there's some fantastic churches here in this community.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we do have good churches.
Incredible. And we actually got a chance, me and my senior pastor, Corey, got a chance to have lunch with another pastor here in town last week. And just hearing him talk about this community, what God's doing, is just incredible. And so, you know, just go on the record and say we are here not to try to compete with other churches. We're here to go after people who aren't in church and really want more than anything to ask those questions and find a place to call home.
We have a lot of denominations here in Cannon County. We do. And they all do a good job. Mm-hmm. But they don't all teach the same.
Sure. Sure.
But we also, and that's the whole thing.
But we also have a lot of people who have alternate lifestyles who mm-hmm. don't feel comfortable in church.
Absolutely.
You know, we have a lot of people like
Absolutely.
That. And because they feel they're going to be judged or maybe that's a sin, so God doesn't love them mm-hmm. when, you mm-hmm. know, the whole thing
sure,
is...
Sure, it, sure,
everyone's
sure.
a sinner,
Absolutely.
You know.
And, that, you know, and yeah. that's something that we really say to anybody is all of us are broken. Mm-hmm. All of us... When we come into a relationship with God, ultimately it's not about us. Mm-hmm. Ultimately it's about God. And so no matter what your brokenness is, no matter what your hang up is, no matter what your habit is, no matter where you're at, you're welcome. Because ultimately when we come into a relationship with God, the answer for our brokenness is not us gritting our teeth and trying harder. It's meeting Jesus. Mm-hmm. And Jesus hung out with the religious people. Jesus hung out with tax collectors. Jesus hung out with prostitutes. Jesus hung out with people that we wouldn't let our kids hang out with.
Yeah.
I mean, if we're being honest about the scriptures, being honest about the gospel narratives, there's some people that Jesus would hang out with that would make religious people squirm. But if we're following Jesus and we're creating a community that looks like Jesus, we want it to look like Jesus and the yeah. ministry that he did and to engage the people that he did. And so that's really the culture that we want to create. So, yeah, I mean, absolutely. Anybody.
And, you can't help someone if you won't talk to them.
Absolutely. If you don't know their name or you don't know their story.
That's right.
Yeah. And everybody's got one. Everybody's
yeah,
got
do.
A story.
Absolutely.
They sure do.
Absolutely.
Well, it sounds
well,
like Josh, a great place.
You're kind of looking for a home right now. You're kind of
we are.
Checking out the area, so...
It's funny, we talked on the phone earlier, and you kind of said, so are you guys, do you know where you're going to be yet? I said, well, Cannon County, somewhere, you know? Ultimately, the church is not a building. Ultimately,
right.
the church is a group of people. So it doesn't really matter necessarily where we land in terms of the brick and mortar that we choose to meet. But we do have options that we're looking at in some different places where we'll be meeting. So we're in the process of trying to find a place to meet right now. So we're excited about that. Yeah.
Well, all right. Well, I wish you luck.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. I do.
Yeah, and August 27th. August 27th is our launch Sunday. So I know that seems
well,
a long
so what
way
does that
away.
Mean?
So launch Sunday is basically when we start this whole thing off.
Okay.
That does not mean we won't be in the county between now and then, because you'll be probably seeing a lot of me at different events, and you can't get rid of me that easily. I'll just be around. So really, we want to come in between now and then and just serve the community and get to know the community, get to know how we can serve the community, get to know the needs of the community. And then on August 27th, that Sunday, that's going to be our first service. And so that's going to be where we talk about the vision, where we talk about where we feel like God is leading us and calling us. And yeah, and then after that, we're going to get right to it, starting the book of Acts in the fall. So we're excited about it.
Okay. Well, good luck.
Well,
thank
good
you.
Luck.
Thank
Very
you so
good.
Much for having
yeah.
me.
Yeah, and now that you're a member, you're welcome to come to the meetings whenever we have them.
Absolutely.
They're not real exciting, but
but they're fast, which is
yes.
exciting to me.
Well,
they don't last 3 or 4
and
hours.
And you guys
they're...
have free food sometimes, and so I'm always a
Yes,
so
we do.
So, yes, ma'am. I might pick you up on that.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Thank you guys.
Well,
very,
very much.
Well,
yeah.
thank you very much. We're going to take a break right now, and then we'll have some more guests. Okay, we're back now, and we have two new guests with us, and of course... These are not strangers to you. Ann Unfound, Bertram are with the Friends of Edgar Evans State Park, and they do a lot of work during the year. And of course, as the weather warms up, then the events start popping, and Edgar Evans State Park is no exception. Anna, we're going to start with you. When is your first event in March? I only knew of one, then
Saturday.
You told me.
Saturday. Actually, we have 4 events in March, and the first one will be April 4th on Saturday.
What, March 4th?
March 4th.
Oh, I thought now you're confusing me.
Yeah,
that was her plan to confuse us. That's okay.
For I'm once in her life, confused. She's confused.
That's all right.
Right. So far, we have 4 events planned for March.
Okay, so what's next Saturday?
That will be the Weed Wrangle.
The Weed Wrangle.
I haven't heard
Actually,
of this one.
Actually, this is a new statewide park event. But at Edgar Evans. We will meet at 9 o'clock at the Millennium Trailhead, and we'll work till noon. And mostly we'll be removing privet, which I'm not, you know, privet used to be raised some as a hedge, a decorative hedge, and in some parts of the country they still do. But unfortunately, at least in our environment, it takes off wild.
Oh.
And what's bad about it is that where it grows, it kills some of the native plants.
Oh.
It takes away their nutrients and sun and, mm-hmm. and all of that. So it's considered an invasive species because it spreads so quickly and takes hold. That is one of the things that, the main thing that we
what
will be removing
that day. What was the name of
that? Privet.
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 P-R-I-V-E-T. I used to have a privet hedge when I lived in Auburntown. It was there when I moved there, and I pruned it every few days.
Protected
and
it.
It's so pretty. And I didn't know that it was
a weed.
Yeah, a bad thing. Of course, all a weed is, Carolyn,
I know.
Is a plant that grows where it shouldn't grow
right.
and thrives.
I have a lot of them.
You know, kind of off the subject, but years ago when I was in California for the first time, in Southern California for Thanksgiving, uh-huh. I was surprised at the miles and miles and miles of boulevards that were landscaped with living poinsettias.
Yeah, I had them in my backyard.
And they're weeds from Mexico. You know, in Mexico they're weeds. Here we buy them in the floral
yeah,
shop.
Yeah, we do.
You know? But they had planted yeah, them as yeah. a landscaping plant there.
Yeah.
So that's all that an invasive plant really is, or any weed, is it's a plant that grows where it shouldn't grow, and it thrives.
And you can't stop it.
It's hard to get rid of. That's right. Well, I'm not saying privet's the only plant that we'll be fighting. We have some others there that are equally difficult, but this one's the most easily
identifiable. So
at this time of year.
At this time of year.
At this time of year to the layman.
Yeah.
Because the leaves are little and green, and they kind of shine when the sun shines on them, and it's kind of a shrubby little good plant. But some, you know, unattended, they can grow as large as a tree.
Wow. So if people are coming out, they need to bring their own work gloves and things like that, or?
We yes. recommend that they
yeah.
they wear sturdy footwear or yeah. boots. They bring drinking water. They bring their own work gloves if they have them. We will have a few there. Their own tools if they have them, which would include things like fire rakes and mattocks and clippers and hedge clippers and
loppers.
The
heavy equipment.
Yeah. Chad and I were there yesterday for a demonstration and the presentation of a new tool to our park by a man from Nashville from the Invasive Plant Society. Is it
the Invasive Plant Removal Incorporated?
Okay.
Wow.
Anyway, he came and brought us a new $150 tool. Don't ask me the name of it, but it works.
An uprooter.
Mm-hmm. But it's primarily for privet, and it works on a fulcrum basis, leverage,
okay.
so that it doesn't take a lot of skill or strength to pull one out by the roots. We're talking about one that's probably that up to that large. Now, your larger privets have
that's the diameter of the trunk you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah.
Okay.
The larger privet plants have to be cut down with chainsaws, and they don't want just anybody doing chainsaws in the parks. So we're just doing this size with this tool.
Well, you're going to have everybody fighting over that, Anna. That.
There'll be a lot of plants and all that we'll use, or trees that we'll be pruning. We'll be doing like, what do you call it, lopping. And there'll be something for everybody to do. But if you have your tools, bring them. If not, there'll be a few tools there in addition to. We'll try for everyone that wants to get a chance to use this new tool. And we're planning on ordering several of them through the state's IRIS fund.
Okay.
so that on future weed wrangles.
And the IRS fund is the license plates that you see that says Tennessee State Parks and got the picture of the IRS there. For every one of those you buy, a part of that goes into a fund to provide tools and equipment and everything for the individual state parks.
I didn't know that.
We have a purple license plate as
well. We have three of them.
Well, as one of my friends here in Kenny County calls it, my purple license plate. It has the iris on it.
Right,
that
I've
is
seen
pretty.
It.
Yes,
I think there are four of them in the county. We have three of them, and Lori Christensen has the other one.
So Lori's out there a lot, isn't she?
She is. She's on our board of directors, and she's an active volunteer. I have. I'll just quickly run over, that's okay. I'll quickly run over the other events for March.
Okay, right.
And then I'll go back to advertise and promote the waterfall tour. But we have the Weed Wrangle on March 4th, and the on March 11th and 12th, a brand new event, which will be an introduction to camping.
Oh.
For those people that would like to try out camping and maybe are afraid to try it on their own. It's $35 per person, and reservations can be made at the office. They
and
just
how,
need to call the park office.
And how long?
They go on Saturday, early afternoon, and they're out about the same time on Sunday.
Okay. Meals so you actually be, camp. So you,
yes.
you actually spend the night. Okay.
And meals
I
will
want
be furnished.
I want a cabin.
Well, we're not having an introduction to cabins, but I'll get onto that subject in a little bit, Carolyn. But anyway, it's it will be conducted by rangers, and the meals are furnished out of that $35.
Oh, so nice.
Take your snacks.
That's a good deal. But you need to bring your own camping equipment.
I'm not sure just how much is needed, but if you call the park office and perhaps leave a message for the ranger to return the call. They can fill you in on it.
So it's not glamping. It's not like glamour camping. It's camping.
It's like camping.
I've never been camping.
Oh, I have. This is a chance.
I think I would like glamping better. I think
you
I want to
go
on a cabin.
With me.
I want to go on a cabin.
I'll tell you about that too.
Okay.
But anyway, then on March 18th, there's two events. And the first one I'll mention is a spring hike, which will be 8 miles strenuous.
Okay.
And it is with a ranger and the state naturalist, Randy Hedgepath. I always tell people if they've never hiked with Randy, they need to do that. He is not only very knowledgeable, but he's also very entertaining.
Very good to know.
And it will be an all-day hike. You'll need to take a lunch. Are you going to do this, Carolyn?
No, he could entertain me while I was crying, sitting on that log, crying.
Let me tell you, if you sit on that log, it may turn dark before you get out of there.
Or you could get bit.
So you don't do this one unless you're fit.
Okay.
And somehow there was some mix-up, and the Tennessee Conservationist magazine that comes out of the state says that it's a 2-mile hike on the nature trail. So
it's not. It's 8 miles
and it's not on a trail.
It's
well,
on a trail.
It's on a trail, but it's 8 miles and it's
trail.
A strenuous trail. Lots of altitude change and rocks and all of that kind of stuff. So
you're dragging me in more and more every
one.
Minute.
But this is for you, Carolyn, on March 18th, the same date is the annual waterfall tour of Edgar Evans State Park. It's one of our major fundraisers of the year. We take a school bus and we go to 3 waterfalls. This year it'll be
Ozone
Falls, Waterloo Falls, and the City Park Falls at Cookeville. And we'll have lunch out at the Golden Corral in Cookeville. Return to the park about 3:30 in the afternoon. This requires reservations, but it's only $15 a person.
That's such a deal.
It
and
is.
It's easy to make online reservations. Even Carolyn can do online reservations.
Maybe.
It's $15 plus the cost of your lunch at the Golden Corral.
And the reservation is simple through our website. And I think that our Colby is going to put it on there for us. But I'll tell you quickly, it's www.f. FRIENDSOEESP.com. And if that's all you remember, that's okay. That stands for Friends of Edgar Evans State Park, the FOEESP.com. If you're not where you can write that down, like you're driving in right now, just remember Friends of Edgar Evans State Park.com, the initials. If you're where you can write it down, you can add waterfall tours or waterfall tour singular dash. No, it's waterfall-tour. It'll take you directly to the information about the waterfall tour. But either way, you'll get there, and it'll have a link to make your reservations. We really simplified it this year.
Well, good.
And then I will give a pitch, too, on April 8th, our annual celebration of spring by the Friends of Edgar Evans State Park and the park employees. And it's a full day of fun for everyone in the family. If you don't have a family, there's something for you to do anyway. If you're young and single and want to bring a sweetheart, that's okay too. There's something for you to do. If you're a grandparent and you want to bring a child and enjoy a special day with your grandchild, that's good too. It'll have wildlife entertainment. It'll have live entertainment. It will have the dancers from Cannon County Arts Studio.
Oh.
We'll have hikes and nature hikes with wildflower identification. There will be $2 boat rides. That's a bargain. And on top of that all, this year, since it's before Easter, at noon, there will be an Easter egg hunt.
Oh, that's fun.
On the Millennium Trail with prizes. So it will be a big event starting at 8:30 in the morning and ending somewhere around 3:30 in the afternoon. All free, unless you want concessions or a boat ride for $2. So those are our big things that are going on right now.
Lots of stuff. That sounds exciting.
Hey, listen, when my grandkids were little, I would have loved to have drug them off somewhere like that and done all that stuff with them.
It's fun.
It is.
It's fun even though they're not so little anymore, Carolyn.
No, they're not. They're more than not so little.
But there's something for everyone. There's even things, you know, for big people.
Right.
Who are parents or grandparents.
Well, yeah, you could go to this celebration of spring and you know, if you were single or whatever, if you didn't find something you like, you could always pull weeds. You're not involved.
But we have one of the more entertaining and educational programs scheduled for this. I think this year it's going to be a desert presentation. This man, Bob Tarter, lives down in Columbia, and he has all kinds of different kinds of animals, kangaroos and prairie dogs, and I mean just all kinds of stuff. And they're a touch type thing where the kids are doing.
It's like a petting zoo type.
Well,
of
it's
thing?
Not. He carries them around.
Oh, I see.
And he's very entertaining, and the animals are just outstanding. And also, we've got a show coming from one of the park rangers, David Haggard from Memphis, with the Birds of Prey, and he has even a bald eagle.
Wow.
That's a part of his show. And there's all kind of, well, and we have one of our park rangers and his wife have all kinds of different snakes.
Oh.
And
they usually can be petted.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to the cabin when y'all do that.
But they do a demonstration with all these snakes. They had a rather unfortunate thing. Their 10-foot boa constrictor, Cortez, died this last week. He was about 18 years old.
Wow.
And they're mourning that loss. But,
I imagine they are.
I don't know if I can mourn that much.
Well, of course, their snakes are a part of their family.
Sure.
I know that. I know that. I wouldn't laugh.
You're just not a snake person?
Not at all. Well, there's one other thing that I am. Of course, we're running out of time now, but there's one other thing that I want to talk to you about. And I had emailed you, I believe. I read a little bit about this, and I just know enough about it to be dangerous, probably. And that is about the privatization of our parks.
Yes.
At what point are we at that?
Well, you know, there was a town hall meeting, so-called, over to the senior citizen. May Beavers and Mark Pody were there. And it was one of those things where it wasn't open for discussion. But I brought it up, and Pody told me, well, it's on hold. Well, it's not. What is happening, the state is proposing to put up $22.2 million, tear down Fall Creek Falls, the inn and the restaurant, everything is leveling, and spend $22.2 million to build a new one and then turn it over to a private operation. Now, what they're proposing to do is almost half the rooms that are in the inn right now, and double the price for the rooms. They want to make it a luxurious thing. They want to make it a resort instead of a state park. And it's going to put it out of the reach of the average Tennessee family. It's like $59 for a room now. It's going to be well over $100 if this goes through.
Does that include the park lands?
No.
Or just the amenities?
It's the inn, the restaurant, the golf course, the cabins, and the conference center. All of that would be privatized. The land itself would not be.
Okay. It would still be a state park.
Yeah, but still in all, when you take those five things, you've gutted the park as far as
right.
that goes. So there are a lot of us that are very opposed to this, and it has not gone through. It's open for bids, but it's not finalized yet. So what I'm saying, write your congressman, write your representative, write your senator. It wouldn't do any good for Beavers and Podium because they'll go along with anything that Haslam says. But write them anyway and let them know where you stand on it.
Okay, so, there it is. Well, I'm against privatizing our state parks. I am.
Well,
but I don't know if I know enough about it to say, you know, I just needed to know more about it.
Well, so. That's the story on it.
Okay.
But
now, is this all of our state parks, or just
Fall Creek Falls
is the
toe in the water? If it goes there, every park that's got an inn, every park that's got a conference center, you know, that's what's going to follow.
Okay.
That's the camel will have its nose under the tent.
Okay. There you go. Okay. Thank you all again for coming and telling us all this. And that was very interesting. I'm glad that I asked you about
it. What he thinks.
That's okay. I wanted to know, you know, because I didn't know enough about it to, I guess, make a decision. But I guess now I probably have. But we welcome both of you coming on here, and also our state parks are people, I don't think people realize what an asset that is to the state by itself.
That's
our
true.
State park.
There are people in Cannon County that don't even know where Ed Gravis State Park is. They don't know anything about it. And what we're trying to do as a friends group is interest people in the park. This is the reason we sponsor all these activities. So,
and you guys volunteer your time?
Yes.
It's all volunteer.
We're always looking for more volunteers.
Okay.
No, we have no paid people at all. And we give a lot of our time, and there are a lot of other people that volunteer their time, too.
Well, we appreciate that very much.
Okay.
Thank you for doing that.
A lot of people who do use our state parks.
Yeah.
Yes.
They do, for fishing, boating, camping, all kinds of things.
We try to make it where a family can come and enjoy nature and get their kids out, away from video games and this type.
That's right. Well, all right. Now I know that if I don't hurry up and go out there and get a cabin, it may go up.
Oh, I was going to tell you about the cabins. They are in the process of updating the cabins.
Oh, okay.
They were adequate, but they're going to be very nice, and they're not raising the rent, as far as I know.
All right.
But they're putting in granite countertops and
there you go.
And redesigning the kitchens, adding more cabinets.
No, I don't know if I want to cook in or not.
Well, a lot of people do, though.
Well, the only thing you have to bring is your groceries.
That's right.
Everything else is fine.
Bring your and your coffee filters.
Oh, well, I can do that. I can do that.
Okay. Well, thank you, Carolyn, for having us. It's always good to be able to get our message out.
Well, thank you.
We appreciate you coming.
I'm sure that I'll see both of you again before this year.
I'm sure you will. You can't get rid of us, can you?
No, it's fine. This is a good thing. People should do more camping.
Thank you.
It's true.
Thanks, guys. Thank
you. You're welcome. Welcome back. We are now going to go into some of our events that are, you know, when March, when the weather starts getting warmer, then the events start happening, and a lot of our organizations and people who sponsor events, they really get to rolling, and then pretty soon you've got something, and sometimes more than one thing, on every weekend. But that's okay, because that helps keep us vibrant.
That's
and
true.
We like that, don't we?
We like to be vibrant. And if you notice today, we're in the gift shop of the Art Center, and we've got wonderful items here that are for sale. That it's just beautiful around here. And while we're talking about the Art Center, let me tell you a few things that are going on. We're finishing up the Lion King Jr., which is sold out April 15th. So that has been a great show. I know it's just packed.
I think this Saturday is the last event. I'm sorry, I put that down there wrong. April 15th is for the...
Sorry about that. Never mind about the Lion King show.
It does have one more show on Saturday.
It has one more show, but it's sold out. The Tennessee Mafia Jug Band. I'm confused here.
They're going to be there in April.
April 15th? All right. Okay. And then April 24th through April 8th, the Southern Hospitality will take center stage. And those are always really fun. They have a great cast and do a great job on that. June 2nd through the 17th will be Peter and the Starcatcher. And auditions for Annie will be showing in July, will be held on April 9th and 10th by appointment only. So please call the Art Center at 615-563-2787 for information.
Especially if you would like to perform in that.
That's right. I always wanted to be Miss Hannigan in that. But I can't carry a tune worth a flip. So there you go.
Well, I can't do anything where you sing. And probably I couldn't do anything where you dance anymore. I guess I'd have to do the lighting. I don't know. Maybe that would work. Okay, and then Friday, April 14th, the Woodbury Lions Club will present the Princess Ball, and that's a father-daughter dance. One of my favorite events to work in and to be involved in, because we have a DJ and they have food. It is a father or father figure, like if it's a grandfather or an uncle, and the little girls. And they come in there. Well, they're dressed as everything. Some of them are dressed as princesses. Some of them have on their Sunday clothes, their Easter dress. And the fathers are usually very dressed up for that, but there's some that aren't. But what amazes me is, and it's all ages of the men, they get out there and dance the bunny hop and Miley Cyrus. And I love that. I love it. I think it is so nice. We have a disco ball. It will be at the Senior Center, and you can call me. And I'll be sure and get you an application for that. They will be sent out to the schools. It's $25 a couple, and then $10 for each additional girl, like if they're sisters. And it's for ages 18 to, we've had their daddies bring babies. So, but they all have a good time, and we have a lot of good food. And we look forward to that, and that will be on April 14th at the Senior Center from 6 until 8:30. Oh, what else? Saturday, April 22nd, is going to be the Cruise In on the Square. That will be the first one that we're conducting this year, and probably we won't have another Cruise In the rest of the summer, but our Color of Fall car show will be on September 23rd. But April 22nd, it'll be on the square. It'll be the Cruiser of the Month Award, which will be presented by O'Reilly's Auto Parts. And they've been real good to us over the years. And they'll have door prizes, trivia, 50-50 concessions. You'll have a good time. Moonlight Drive-In will be giving away movie tickets. So you get a lot, and it doesn't cost you anything. So please join us on the square. Last year, our April one was the biggest one we had all year besides the car show. Let's see, April 28th and 29th and 30th, stores on and around the square will be holding their spring fling. And of course, we have a lot of antique stores, and they will be giving away door prizes and surprises, and some of them have entertainment and, of course, refreshments. It's a fun time to come and shop in Woodbury, and that will be on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So make your way down here, if not one day, all days, and I promise you, you'll have a good time. Let's see, and then, of course, we'll be getting into May, so you're going to be having events that we'll go into next month. That'll be wagon train rides, mule shows, good old days, and so much more. The drive-in will be open by that time, but you will have so much more to enjoy during the months to come. One other thing, you want to talk about the teachers
there? Yes, I want to congratulate three teachers in Cannon County who were awarded Teacher of the Year on the district level. Miss Joy Pope is the resource teacher at Woodbury Grammar School. Miss Alicia Pitts, librarian at Woodland Elementary School, and Mr. Mark Larson, 9th and 10th grade economics teacher at Cannon County High School. They will continue in the process for State Teacher of the Year, so congratulations to them. That's a hard job being a teacher, and it's sometimes a thankless job, but we appreciate them so much and very proud of them.
And I'm sure, I know all of these teachers, and I'm sure that any one of them is very deserving of Teacher of the Year. Mark Larson's great.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And so is Joy Pope and Alicia too. So
yeah.
Well, we want to thank you for being with us for this hour. The weather has let up a little bit. We're not pouring down rain right now. But we appreciate you being with us, and our time is up, and we'll see you in April.